In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the gift of our lives. We thank you for the gift of community, of education, and of family. Just ask you, Lord, that as we come here this evening to take from us all the burdens, all the weariness of the day, to refresh our bodies, and to clear our minds so that we may understand more fully and clearly where you are moving and how you have moved throughout our human history, bringing about your glory in our times. We just ask you, Lord, to give me the words to speak which you wish me to speak. Give those the ears to hear the message which you wish them to hear, and help us all to have a greater appreciation of your love for all of us as you've manifested your will throughout all of human time. We ask all this through the intercession of the words which Christ gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Well, welcome back, everyone, to this last of our series of three on church history. We will hopefully finish tonight in the approximately about between the 12th and 14th century. So I'm going to try to cover 1,100 years. And I might go a little bit longer tonight, just to cover everything and to finish up. So we might go until about 9 o'clock. So I'll probably break for a few minutes. Someone can give me about a halfway point so we can break for a bathroom break. And then we'll finish up about 9 tonight. So I'm going to try to move as quickly. But if you do have any questions, just please raise your hand. I'll be more than happy to answer any questions as we go along. So just a recap of where we were last time and what we covered. We covered pretty much the first 300 years of the church and the progression, especially during the persecutions. We also talked about the gradual split on both a social and on religious lines along the split between Jews and Christians. The first being the mark which really distinguishes Jews from Christians will be at the Council of Jerusalem, where under the leadership of St. Paul and St. Peter and St. James, as well as the other 12, is that you have a split because they will abandon the Mosaic law, or the law of circumcision, as well as the dietary practices. You can read about this in the book of Acts. Then you find, again, the rebellion against Rome by the Jews, which will lead to this Fidiscus tax, this Judas Fidiscus tax, which the Christians in 98 will petition and request that they no longer have to pay. You'll also find a gradual growth in the Jewish faith themselves as the Pharisees will meet at various places, one of the most prominent being at Yamnia, where they will kind of go back and no longer recognize the Greek scriptures, the Septuagint. So there you find a split along religious lines and what is the Word of God. Christians will still follow the Septuagint, which will be the what we would recognize today as being the Old Testament in the Catholic Bible, and so forth and so on. So as you get to that point where finally the Judas Fidiscus, the Christians are no longer obliged to do this, now they will be recognized by Rome as being a new religion. Also a religion which they will immediately, the Romans, will immediately suspect and start accusing of being a type of superstitious religions. We went into kind of the understanding of superstitious, the way that the Romans understood that this is a very negative thing which they wanted to stamp and crush out, along the same lines as like the Manichaeans or the Druids or things like this. So when you go through, again, all those different persecutions, realizing that it's not a consistent 200 years of persecution, but it's more of a rising up, a going down, usually in response to either plagues or in response to natural disasters or losses in battles, things like this, is where Christians will be the scapegoat. Very commonly also one of the reasons why Christians will be the scapegoat and why this will happen so frequently is that Christians, for the most part, are not going to fight back in terms of physical violence. Many of the early Christians are going to be pacifists, although you're going to see this rise, especially within the military, of Christians who soldiers will start becoming in mass actually Christians. And this will be a huge point of conflict for the Romans, who don't want any of their traditional soldiers to be influenced by these newfangled superstitious beliefs as the Romans see Christianity. The last persecution, the last major persecution which will strike the empire will be under actually one of its greatest reformers. If you look back on a secular level at Emperor Diocletian, Diocletian on a secular level will be actually a great emperor. He's all about prosperity. He's all about improving the traditional values of the Roman Empire. And one of the things that he will stamp out and go after with a vengeance is anything which undermines traditional Roman values. But for the most part, actually, Diocletian, in terms of secular rule, will be, for the most part, actually pretty moderate. He's not really a warlord. He's not going to be too much of a person who's trying to dictate things. He's trying to recreate the traditional Roman society. So what Diocletian will do, Diocletian will split, actually kind of showing the prudence of Diocletian. He'll realize that, you know, it's probably not best to rule the empire by myself. So he will actually split the empire into what's called the rule of two. And the second man, a man by the name of Maximian, will be the military head of the empire. Diocletian will be the governmental head of the empire. Just again, this might be a little bit of a simplification, but that's basically what happens, is that Maximian will be recognized as being the other Augustus Caesar, is that you, then you'll have this rule of two, which will actually eventually get split into a rule of four. And so some of you might remember this from your history classes in high school or in college, where then you'll have the rule of four, which will be under Constans over in the west, and then you'll have Galerius. Now, out of all of this during this time is that you're going to have also a slight change in the way in which the emperors are viewed. Because up until this time, what Diocletian will do is that Diocletian also, with Maximian, they will start comparing themselves to the gods. Because actually the way in which they will even advertise themselves, trying to get the popular support of the people, is that Diocletian will be viewed almost as if he's a Jupiter or of a kind of Jove, again, the traditional Zeus type figure. And he will actually refer to himself, as well as in state records, you'll find this phrase that he becomes what? The God's representative on earth. This is for the first time, well, actually one of the first times that this is seen in correlation with an emperor, is that they are now the God's representatives on earth. Now, if you just read a few years in the future, you might see how this starts having effects in terms of the society as well as on the church. God's, what does it mean to be God's representative? Now, from this standpoint, that obviously they're not looking at the God being Yahweh, but the pagan gods. So they're the ones who are called to enact the God's will on earth. And this is not really the way that it was understood prior to this time. It'll be for the first time under Diocletian that this will be brought about as a way of using religion specifically to unify people within the empire, which is also why Christianity will be such a grave threat to this notion. It's one of the reasons why also, now Diocletian for the most part will go after Christians and he will allow persecutions, but you're going to find that it's really Maximian who really has no tolerance for Christians, and you'll find that Galerius hates them with a passion. And so actually the worst persecutions will be under Galerius and under Maximian. Diocletian will do them, he'll allow them, but for the most part he's more concerned with money matters and with the ruling of the empire, and only it deals with them in secondary. And you'll find that actually Constans, who's ruling over in the far west, especially in the England and parts of France or Gaul, is that he will actually end up marrying a Christian, and so he will end up being sympathetic. And so this Christian's name, or he'll eventually marry a woman by the name of Helena. Some of you might recognize this name, because this will later give rise to Saint Helena or Saint Helen. And they will have a son whose name will be Constantine. So during this period though, you're gonna find a huge rise in persecutions. They're going to stomp out the Manichaeans, not just Christians, they're going to go after any superstitious sect. The Manichaeans they'll go after them with a vengeance. I'm going to have to go through a little bit this more quickly than I normally do. But it'll be under the reign of Diocletian that you will have a purge of the military, a purge of all Christians. Christians are told that they are no longer welcome, because in the past it was kind of not supposed to be Christian, but you know what, we're not going to really do anything about it. Diocletian and Maximian, especially Maximian and Galerius, will purge the military of all Christians, and they will not allow Christians because they'll recognize that the Roman ideals don't line up with these Christian values. And so they will purge the entire military. It'll be during this time that you'll have the martyrdom of Saint Sebastian. Some of you might recognize St. Sebastian, who will be pierced with arrows, will survive, and he'll go back to Diocletian and tell him and try to convert him, but it'll be unsuccessful, is that he will then be beaten to death after surviving that. Sebastian will become a main martyr within the early church. You'll also find that Marcellinus will be banished on account of his faith, and he'll die in exile. You'll find that Peter of Alexandria in Egypt, you're going to find pretty much across the entire empire. This is for the most part we're going to see an empire-wide real purge and persecution of the Christians. It's also why Diocletian will be recognized as being the worst of the emperors, because he still is the head. He's still recognized as being the head of the empire, although it's really been split by this time. You'll find Peter, Alexandria. You'll also find that Eusebius, a church historian as well as Tertullian, will both attest to a city in Phrygia, which consisted entirely of Christians, that the entire city will be burned and will be, again, there'll be a genocide without this entire city. The whole city will be killed because this was a Christian city. And actually, Christians had flocked. And they will try to stamp out Christianity with a vengeance. During this time, you'll also find Agnes. Agnes, who will also be martyred, a girl of about 13 years old. She'll be beheaded. And when they really start going after young girls, it's really going to turn the stomachs of a lot of society. Is that especially when you start having, actually at this point you'll find that especially the persecutions under Maximin and Galerius will start turning very, very vicious. Even Diocletian will take a step back a little bit from it, and Constantius will refuse outright to actually persecute Christians. And this will become a major source of contention. But it's really a question of what are our Roman values, what are our Roman ideals, and it becomes very much an ideological problem within the empire. So, Constantius will, for most part out in the west, Christians will be safe under Constantius' territory, but especially in parts of Italy and things like this where Galerius is going with a full vengeance trying to stamp out, and it will be him who will be actually the greatest persecutor of the church during this period. Again, Agnes, 13. Constantius and Maximin will stop applying the letter. Galerius will attribute many of as being the ones who's primarily pushing this particular persecution. So then you have the rise of Constantine. I'm not going to get into the full history of Constantine because it's very interesting when you really understand Constantine and all the political intrigue that goes on. But suffice to say that Constantine, the son of Constantius, will eventually have to flee from being pretty much assassinated. He'll come back, he'll take over control of his father's empire when his father dies, and then he will come to a major conflict where he will come to, in 313, the Battle of Milan Bridge. So at the Battle of Milan Bridge, Armillian Bridge, this is where Constantine will come in. And really, some people would look at Constantine as kind of, obviously Christians will see him in a very favorable light. Secular historians will see him as kind of just uniting this very disenfranchised people, the Christians, which is one of the reasons why he's able to gain such great support. He'll march to the bridge, and he will ultimately have a huge victory in 310, and then later on the Edict of Milan will basically legitimize Christianity as being a valid religion where you can now practice it freely. It's actually a freedom, it's religion of tolerance decree that goes out for tolerance of religions throughout the Roman Empire, of Christianity in particular. Or religious tolerance, yes?
Did you mention the standard banner that they had?
Yes. So when Constantine shows up at this battle, according to tradition, is that he was praying that evening and he has a vision, and in the vision, he sees a vision in the sky that says that in this sign you will conquer. And so the sign which he sees is the Cairo, Christ's name. So on his standards, it's the first time actually in Roman history that a Roman general had marched into battle with the sign of the Cairo, or of Christ's name, on his standards. He had actually taken standards, washed them, and had painted this symbol on it. And he will march into the battle, drive his enemy actually into the water where his competing general will drown. He will march pretty much right into Rome, take control of the empire, and will become the de facto ruler of the Roman Empire. He won't actually kill the other. There's pretty much a policy. You don't really kill your competing generals. You kind of exile them, or you send them off to their farms, which is actually pretty much what he'll do with most of his enemies, except for the ones that he kills in battle. Constantine, though, is brilliant in terms of being both a brilliant military commander as well as a brilliant administrator. And so actually under Constantine, you'll find that the Roman Empire will flourish. So with the Edict of Milan, let's see if this is gonna work. It's gonna be very sad if it doesn't work. There you go. You'll find that still there's major centers of Christianity at this time, huge populations. And also within Rome, Jerusalem, Antioch, and Alexandria, you're gonna find these to be huge centers of Christianity, which is why actually Constantine will still be widely popular throughout the empire. Because for the most part, the persecutions have left a bad taste in the mouths of most people, especially when they start seeing the massacre and the killings of whole cities, which they have not really seen in the past, as well as with the murders of young children and things like this, and pretty much it'll leave a bad taste. And for the most part, most people, even people who are not Christians, are ready for the persecutions. They're kind of over and done with it. So Constantine will make quick use, though, of the existing hierarchical structure of the church, because there was hierarchy within the church. But what Constantine will do is that now the Christian empire or Christianity throughout the empire will become Constantine's favored religion. He will not convert to Christianity until his deathbed, which was not uncommon at that time. And one of the reasons for this would be because at baptism, it's understood that you wash away all of your sins. So many people will delay baptism until death so they wash away all of their sins.
Until they can have fun,
or because they don't want to have anything after baptism which sullies their garments. Constantine will, some people say that he converts. Actually, for the most part, what historians will say is that it looks like it was upon his deathbed that he will actually convert to Christianity. But Christianity will become his favored religion. He still retains the title of Pontifex Maximus, or the supreme religious leader of the pagan cults. And so he will be required by Roman laws to still participate within the Roman functions of the Roman law, of the Roman state religion. But what you will start seeing is that Constantine will gradually start moving the religion of the Roman Empire towards Christianity. He'll make it very favorable. He'll also start pouring vast amounts of money into building basilicas, and that's where you start seeing the rise of the basilica-style church, which is a big long hall which looks very similar to an ancient pagan temple. So if you go to like St. Paul's outside the walls in Rome, it is a basilica style, which is a big square box style, usually with colonnades down the sides. This will be different than the type of church building which develops during the Middle Ages, which is of the T-shaped cross, which will come under like Michelangelo and things like that. So the old basilica style will basically, he'll just repurpose, and sometimes he'll just repurpose Roman temples, which have become no longer worshipped in, he'll repurpose them and give them to the Christians, pour monies in for them to be refurbished, or you'll have the creation of entirely new churches. During this time, you'll also find that he will use the existing hierarchical structure in the church, because as soon as Christianity becomes legalized, well, you have a couple things that happen. One, it's no longer dangerous to become a Christian. So you'll have a wide influx of Christians into the faith, people who are not necessarily willing to die for the faith, but people who likewise want to become Christians, and some would say that some of them for nefarious reasons, because they also want to take advantage of all this money, and also the popular cult, the popular religion of the Roman emperor, that Constantine, people who want to get in good with Constantine, will become Christians, and to try to curry favor. So what you'll also see during this time is the rise of people who are not necessarily entering into the Christian faith for the best of reasons. And so many of them also being highly educated but not educated in the faith, only have a very basic understanding, you're going to see a rise of a lot of severe misunderstandings that won't exist up until this time. And what you're going to see especially is the rise in heresy. People especially coming from a Roman background with their familiarity with the Roman gods is that they're going to start applying these things to Christianity. And one of the first ones which will break out will be this disagreement on, is Jesus fully God? Or is he just like a demigod? Is he like Hercules? Is he like this half God, half man? Because they were more familiar with that. But the principle of God becoming a man, is that's also why in the scriptures, even at the time of the apostles, Jesus said, or St. Paul said, that the cross and also the incarnation is an absurdity to Greeks. It's a stumbling block to the Jews. It's an absurdity to the Greeks. The cross, the incarnation, Jesus himself, God becoming, this doesn't make sense to the very rational, reductionistic Greek mind. But what does make sense is their Greek pantheon. So you're going to see this major conflict which will arise in a group which are actually led by a bishop, but a bishop who is not an Orthodox Catholic one, but he will be called, and his name is Arius. And so you will find the rise of what's called Arianism. Arianism, which denies that Jesus is fully God, say that he is a type of God, he is a demigod, but he's not equal to the Father. He's more like Hercules. And what will happen is that Christians will start getting into big, huge fights. Fights that lead to bloodshed. And now, Constantine, for the most part, is very pro-Christian, but he's also very anti-rebellion. He's going to be just like every other emperor before him. He does not like violations of Roman law. And he also does not like any seedings of rebellion. He's not going to like it, especially when it's breaking out within his favorite religion. So what he will actually do is he will call a grouping. He will call all the leaders of the existing church. And he will tell them, you must get together and you must solve this problem. Because there's not going to be violence breaking out in the empire because it's making me look bad. Which you can kind of rationally understand why he's doing this. But so he will take an interest in theological matters, not trying to solve theological matters, but he will bring them to the table and he will start calling, and that's where you will find the first Council of Nicaea is called in 325 to solve this question, because Christians are literally punching each other and shedding blood in the streets. So Christians breaking into violence will lead to the Council of Nicaea to answer the question, is Jesus actually fully God? Especially as you have this influx, 325. And this is where you will actually find that the Nicene Christians, and that's what they will be referred to afterwards, is Nicene Christians versus Arian Christians. Nicene Christians who have the creed which come out, which will be the same creed which has been being talked about since the early time of the apostles, will come out. And this is where you will find the advent of the Nicene Creed, which we still say to this day. The Nicene Creed, which is a little bit different than the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed, which is a little bit more developed, which will come out later, but the Nicene Creed. But the Nicene Creed does not solve all the problems, because Arius still is not willing to give up. And this will still just cause actually a greater problems throughout the empire, because it will actually start splitting different people along religious lines. It will also be at the Council of Nicaea that you'll have Nicholas of Smyrna. Nicholas, who is the successor of one of the communities that St. John the Apostle founded. And if you know anything about St. John's theology, St. John's community, it all stresses the divinity of Jesus Christ. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, John's first gospel. And then so when Arius starts promoting at the council and is given his turn to speak out and to bring forward, Nicholas will walk up in rage and will punch Arius in the face right in the middle of the council. And actually, as a result of this, is that he almost is stripped of his bishopric. He's almost stripped and told you can no longer be bishop, but he's so popular, as well as one of the founding fathers of kind of the Orthodox movement, as well as the Christian movement, is that they really can't do anything to him, although he comes under heavy fire for basically breaking out into violence in the middle of it. And Constantine is very unhappy with Nicholas. But Nicholas also was one who had been tortured during the persecution of Diocletian. And so Nicholas will have no tolerance for this heresy which is coming out, that he himself had been tortured, people in his community had been murdered. And so you'll find, again, a lot of hostility at this time, especially for people who are starting to come into the faith and then they're starting to deny that Jesus is God. So you're going to find this rift that grows up in the Nicene church. Does this make sense? So what will come out of this, though, is that then the question becomes, what is the scriptures? What should be considered the scriptures? Because Christians are no longer having to hide in catacombs, now they can start answering and talking about these questions. And so the question of what is the word of God, how are we to determine what are the authentic writings of the apostles, what are the authentic scriptures, where has God directed and used the Holy Spirit to speak to us? How do we know which is which? Now, for the most part, the Old Testament, they all have, because they're still using the Septuagint. They're still using the Greek translation of the Old Testament that St. Paul and St. Peter used. But what is not compiled at this time is the New Testament. There is no New Testament. So they don't have a Bible like we do. They had an Old Testament, and then they have all these kind of random letters. And some communities use these, some communities use these, some communities use these. Some of them were very common. Some of them had never heard about. Some of them have very clear errors. Some of them are pretty much widely accepted. So when they start, you'll find that the Jews, for the most part, and one of the indications of this is at Yamni as well as elsewhere, the Jews had already kind of abandoned the Greek scriptures. The Christians will not. So this will be for them answered there. You'll find that Athanasius of Alexandria, so again, Athanasius in Egypt, who's the bishop of Egypt, also one of the main things that Athanasius is known for is fighting against the Arians. He's actually chased out of the city of Alexandria three times for them trying to kill him. And this is during the time of Constantine, just shortly after the time of Constantine. Arius will be chased out by the Arians several times. You'll later find that a person who comes later after him, which will be Augustine of Hippo, Africa, because the African church is very strong at this time, very unlike today, in terms of it's a huge Christian population. Augustine will actually be anti-death penalty early on when he's bishop. After he's chased out of the city three times and they try to kill him three times, he actually switches his position. He becomes pro-death penalty, especially for killing the Arians who are trying to kill him. But so you'll find that Athanasius is already starting to bring up this question of that we need to codify. We need to declare and we need to solve this question of what is the word of God. And you'll find that in 367 as he's writing. You'll then find that the Council of Rome will meet and will start discussing this question of what should be considered in the New Testament. What are the books that should be declared? You'll find the Council of Carthage in 397 will address the same issue. And during this time, you're going to have the rise of two prominent leaders, or at least one prominent bishop, and that bishop will be the successor in Hippo, and that will be St. Augustine. St. Augustine will be the main influential bishop at this time. He will have been the main person who had listened to the last most influential bishop will be Ambrose. Ambrose, who was also during the time of Athanasius. Augustine will have listened directly to this great orator, Ambrose, who Ambrose actually, when he was made bishop, he was not even a Christian. But he had been buying into the Christian, and he starts defending Christianity, and people are so impressed with Ambrose that they will actually take Ambrose, they'll baptize him, they'll make him a priest, and they'll make him a bishop pretty much all within the same week. So Ambrose becomes this main defender during the times of Athanasius, around the time of Athanasius. Augustine, who's this great philosophical leader, as well as this great philosophical genius, will be listening to Ambrose. And Monica, his mother, had been praying for him for years, but when he hears Ambrose's teachings, he'll take one-on-one study with Ambrose, and he will actually become a Christian, and then he'll become a major leader within the, especially Egyptian church, the Alexandrian church. So the Council of Carthage in 397, they were discussing what should be in the New Testament, which is the two main leaders, Augustine, who is working on it, and then there will be a scholar who will also work in correlation with Augustine, as they're discussing these things in great detail, and that scholar's name is Jerome. Jerome will be kind of one of the most educated people of the day. He's recognized as being the biblical master of his time. And so they will get into these big, huge discussions on what should be in the scriptures. And this question of should in the Old Testament, when we go back and look at the Old Testament, should we use the Septuagint? Because Jerome will not want to translate into Latin, because that's what they're working on, is translating the entirety of all the scriptures, as well as what's been agreed upon, translating this into Latin, so that everyone can understand the scriptures in the language that they speak, because the predominant language is Latin, which is spoken. But Jerome doesn't want to translate the Bible from the Greek. He wants to go back to the original languages that it was written in. And when he compiles all the different books, he realizes that there's about seven books and a couple of pieces of various other books that are only written in Greek. So this question becomes that rises between Augustine and Jerome is, should we include in the Latin Vulgate, in the translation of the Bible, should we include these books which are written in Greek? And so what Jerome will say is that no. Jerome will say we should not put these in, these are written in Greek. The Old Testament is only written in Hebrew or Aramaic. And what Augustine will come back with him and he'll say, no, the apostles we know use that we are an apostolic church. We look to apostolic traditions. We look to the authority of the apostles. And we know that St. Paul was using the Septuagint. And we know that he considered this to be the word of God. And we do not have the authority to divert from the teachings of the apostles. Which is why, actually, you'll get into these big tiffs between Jerome, who is known as being kind of also having the nastiest tongue, a very acerbic tongue. And he'll actually write to one point to Augustine, he'll say, why am I even conversing with you? You're an uneducated idiot who doesn't even speak Greek. And he'll go back and forth. Actually, that's also why Jerome will almost always in paintings be depicted with a rock. Because he's a hermit who lived in the desert. And some would say he lived in the desert because no one could live around him. And supposedly every time that he let loose with his famous acerbic tongue, he would strike himself with a rock. That's why there was a pope in the Middle Ages who was looking at Jerome, a picture of him one day, and he actually turned to the painting and he was reported as saying, Jerome, without your rock, you would have never made it into heaven. Because we still have his letters to this day. One of the other things he sends back to, as basically as Augustine is winning, because it's also when it gets to a question between a theologian and a bishop, well, one of them has authority and one of them doesn't. And so actually when Jerome realizes that he's losing at various points, he'll write in another point, he'll say to Augustine, he says, I curse you with the fleas of 1,000 armpit hairs. Or basically what he says, I hope you get lice. Which, if you understand that in correlation, it was what? Uneducated, stupid people who got lice. There's always kind of that connotation, which is not true. Anyone can get it. But that's basically what he's saying, because also lice was obviously a huge part of the daily lives of people, especially the unclean. So Jerome will go back and forth, but eventually at council, the councils will affirm, and they will use a criterion to determine what is to be placed in the New Testament. And the criterion which is used is that the first thing is that it had to have been written during the age of the apostles. And the age of the apostles ends in 90 AD with the death of John the apostle. So once the last of the 12 has died, this ends the age of the apostles. Because there was various books that they had been using commonly and reading at Mass, the same way that we read the scriptures at Mass, because the structure of the Mass has really not changed. You can go back to the Didache and read the Didache, what the Mass looked like, and it looks pretty much exactly the same. But you read, and so the first one is it had to be written during the age of the apostles. Anything written afterwards didn't make it in, which is one of the reasons why the Didache does not make it in, because they knew that the Didache, we were pretty certain, came a little bit after John's death. So anything after 90, the letters of Clement, the letters of Barnabas will also be eliminated, although they've been using them extensively throughout their religious services, throughout their Mass, their Eucharist. The second criterion which was used was that it had to have been used in their public Masses, and they have to have been used commonly within the context of the Mass. If they were just popular literature, popular readings, it's also one of the reasons why things like The Life of St. Anthony, which was probably the most popular book in the Roman Empire when it was written, The Life of St. Anthony, which was written by Athanasius, will also be eliminated. They were using it commonly, but it was never used in the context of liturgy. It was never used in the context of the Mass. Books that were not used in the context of the Mass were also eliminated. So it had to be used in the context of the Mass, commonly by most people. It had to be, too, from the age of the apostles before. And also there had to be what's called the regulum census fidei, or it had to be commonly accepted, the regular sense of the faithful. That, and there was also not ever universal. People sometimes think that everyone universally agreed on these things. There's almost never been universal agreement in the Catholic Church. There's always been disagreements, always different people taking. But as long as it was the regular census of the day, within the regular sense of most people, and John's Gospel, the Gospel of John, almost didn't make it in for that reason. Because John's Gospel was one of those ones that was kind of on the borderline, is that a lot of people had not been using it, or a lot of people were not really familiar with it, because it was kind of trapped in certain Johannine communities. But the Johannine communities were most certainly very much pushing it. A lot of people were skeptical, is this Gnostic? Was it like the Gospel of Thomas or things like this? So John's Gospel does almost by a hair make it into the Bible. And then once they've codified it, Jerome will translate all of this, and therefore you will have the first Latin Bible, where you'll find the first cohesive Bible put together, which is written in Latin. Does this make sense? So, yes.
Okay, I'm talking about the letters up until the all the apostles died.
Yes.
Okay. Do we actually have copies of the letters the apostles wrote, or are these things that were written by other people from their congregation based on sermons they gave?
It could have been both. It could have been either or, and we're not always certain exactly which. Out of the ones which were probably most certain, although we can't say with 100% certainty because you're going back 2,000 years, and it's not like they kept records the way that we do today, because they also weren't concerned with history the way that their understanding of history was different than ours. So the ones that were probably most certain that the actual gospel, the writers of the actual letter wrote, John's Gospel, Book of Revelation, Paul's letters, but not all of the letters attributed to Paul. There's some speculation that some of the letters were possibly written from people who were listening to Paul. So it had to have been written before 90 from those communities that it comes out of. So some of them would be either sermons or teachings or things like that, and it would have been transcribed.
Peter, the first head of the church, what happened to his letters?
Well, honestly, you could say that Peter, a lot of people would say that Mark's gospel is Peter's gospel. That Mark's gospel is Peter's gospel, or at least Mark's gospel is highly influenced by Peter. It tends to be the simplest, tends to be it's the earliest. It also comes from Mark, and we know from tradition that Mark was brought back by Peter, and Mark and Peter had a very close relationship. So it makes sense that Mark would have been highly influenced. So if it's not, so therefore you can say that a form of Peter's gospel that Peter was preaching would have come through the gospel of Mark, if that makes sense. Just as you can say that kind of Paul's gospel will come through the lens of St. Luke. St. Luke also tends to focus a lot on the poor. St. Paul likes to focus a lot on the poor and need and things like this. And you find a lot of those same Pauline themes versus Petrine themes in those two gospels. So, that answer your question? Excellent. So, for the most part, this is the scriptures for the next 1,100 years. This is what everyone commonly accepts. You'll have a different, couple different translations that come about later on. But it's not really even a question until the Protestant Reformation. Is that for the most part, across the board, all Christians will accept the Latin Vulgate for the next 1,000 years until the Protestant Reformation, which starts to obviously challenge various questions of, that were based upon authority. So, but up until, and then it won't be until 1563 at the Council of Trent, in response to the Protestant Reformation, is that dogmatically you will have a closing of the Bible. And you will have a dogmatic closing that this is the canon and that there is nothing to be added or subtracted. And that it's pretty much a closed moot issue after 1563 in terms of the actual closing of the scriptures. So Christians who are no longer being persecuted again allows for the church to become more structured because now you can celebrate Mass. And so some people say, well, Constantine created this. No, the church, naturally speaking, always had a structure. And you can see that just by fact of the way that the Romans will go after always the leaders of the local communities. So people who try to say there's no hierarchical and there's no leadership structure in the church prior to the Constantine are not really examining the history accurately. Because we know that because it's exactly the hierarchy, it's the existing structure within the church that exists during the time of persecutions. And there was always, what, episcoposes and presbyters, even from the time of Peter and Paul, and these are mentioned in scriptures. So Constantine's favorite religion, he doesn't recant his high title of Pontifex Maximus. He will still do this, although he will start pouring vast amounts of money. But he will be a major person who will be focused on law and reform. So this is also during the time where you're going to find that this idea of patronage, Constantine will be understood to be, and he will understand himself, to become the patron of the church. He is the one who's the patron. He will take care of the financial matters. He will take care of actually the fiscal realities. The spiritual leaders, the bishops, are to take care of the theological realities as well as the day-to-day things. But in terms of being a patron, he will actually adapt what was a very common practice at the time, this notion of patronage. Some of you might be familiar in terms of, again, this goes to the old Greek culture, this idea of the patronage system, everyone having a patron. And you'll find this actually moving forward into the future where the popes will become the patrons of various artists. And so you'll have Julius II who will become the patron of Michelangelo. So, but during this time, you'll have that Constantine will become the patron of the church and start pouring vast amounts of money and wealth. He'll send his mother, Helena, to Israel to try to find any relics from the time of Christ. And that's where Helen will come back with the true cross. She'll come back with the cross. And there is actually, when Helen goes over there, they will know within, I believe it was 18 minutes, Constantine knew within 18 minutes when his mother found the cross. And because they will actually use the fires that were on the mountaintops, which was always the way in which the Romans were able to declare, you know, if they were being invaded. And so there was different signal fires and things like that in the ancient times. So actually, they will use the signal fires to alert Constantine within about 18 minutes of when Helena will find the true cross and will uncover the true cross. She'll bring back these relics from Israel. She'll bring back also a lot of other things from Israel and come back, and you'll start having the mass veneration of different things that they would have. Because then the same thing was also true in the ancient time with Rome, is that the Romans were very accustomed to having tangible objects that they could go and see. So you had all these different relics from times, and this would transfer into the church. But again, this is not something which is entirely new. You're going to still have this during the time of Polycarp. You're going to have the veneration of relics. All these different, and the reason why the Christians have still held on to this is because they have not let go of these things. And so you're going to have this mass cult of relics, which is also going to rise during this time. You're also going to start having the peddling in bad relics. Because anyone who can make a buck, obviously, is also going to try to take advantage of this. This is why you can go to Rome today. And I laugh because I went to Rome and I found three pillars upon which Jesus was scourged. So in terms of this, you're going to find, again, a lot of also, you're going to start seeing the corruption, just as we find with anything. You're going to start seeing this, but you're still going to find a lot of authentic spirituality which is going on. This is the basilica-style church, if you can see it. Again, long, narrow, with columns on the sides, which is basically just a redo of the old pagan temples, which is why you can go into the, and this is what pretty much it looks like inside for many of them. Also, you can go into many churches, especially in Rome. You'll find a lot of these. So, Nicene Christianity will become the official religion of the Holy Roman Empire, or of the Roman Empire in 380. So 313 is when there's Christian tolerance, religious tolerance throughout the empire. and 313. It won't be, again, for another 67 years that you will have Christianity actually officially adopted as the state religion of the Roman Empire. During this time, though, you have a lot of monies which are being poured in to the church. So the Roman government had always used religion as a way of bringing unity and bringing stability to the people, and Constantine will do exactly the same thing. Constantine will slowly start to try to undermine all the different other state religions that had been practiced in the past, especially things which are pagan. All these things will pretty much just kind of be shunted off the door. And pretty much he'll stop pouring monies into those, and he'll start pouring much more monies into the church. So from 320, he's going to undermine paganism. You're also going to find that the Christians, using especially people like Justin Martyr and different philosophical leaders of the day, are going to start enacting traditions, and they're going to say, well, what's the best way that we can bring Christianity on a massive level to many peoples? Well, the best way is to look at those things within the Christian culture which are not antithetical, or within the pagan culture which are not opposing our faith, and just adopt them. So this is where you'll also find that the creation of, for instance, December 25th being chosen as Christmas Day. Well, Jesus was most certainly not born Christmas on 25th of December. If you look at actually the calendar and things like that, he was probably born sometime during the month of June. But the reasoning for the birthday of Christ being a way of celebrating also is a way of promoting Christianity. And so what they did is they adopted a pagan holiday, and they basically will just say, well, now we're not going to worship this God anymore. We're going to worship the one God. On this is the day that we will choose to celebrate his day of birth. And the justification for it, there'll be a man by the name of Justin Martyr. If you remember going back to the first century, Justin Martyr, also called Justin the Philosopher, he will have this in his writings. He will write and be preaching to his community about that, this understanding of what's called the Logos Spermaticos. That when God created the world, he created all cultures, he placed the seed of truth into every human being's heart. Therefore, within groupings of human beings, groupings of people who have come together, cultures, many cultures have the seed of truth. The Logos, the Word, wisdom, Jesus Christ, before he becomes flesh, present in seed form in those cultures. And therefore, in those areas where you can find common truths with the cultures, those things which you can find things which are not bad, but can lead to God, we can adapt these things. And we can likewise use them for Christianity. So a day, a feast day, a holiday, there's nothing wrong with this. If you're worshiping Baal, or you're worshiping Zeus, or you're worshiping one of these, yes, because it's going to lead you astray. But the day, the holiday, there's nothing wrong with that. Let's just baptize it. Let's baptize it the way that we're baptizing people and getting rid of their sins. Let's baptize days. And so that's exactly what the Christians will do, using Justin Martyr as well as other early patristic writers talking about the baptizing of things like this. And so what you'll have is you'll have a lot of these things where you'll find a lot of the ancient Roman traditions will just be converted into Christianity or absorbed into Christianity. Feast days, again, you're going to find a lot of the same feast days of old Roman holidays will just be reconverted into Christian ones. And they didn't see this as being a problem because of the notion of baptism and also of Logos Spermaticos and other things like this. Does this make sense? It also becomes highly effective because you try to get a person to change their favorite holiday and then you tell them they can't do it, they have to do it the following day. We tried to actually do that. They tried doing it actually with All Saints Day. All Saints Day, which is November 1st, moving away from this pagan holiday of Samhain or of Halloween, where all the devils and ghouls ran out, so they tried to do it. But people still have always liked that October 31st. It's been very hard to move the day one day forward, even if we call it, we call Halloween, what, All Souls Day. So we have all these different things, but again, people like that particular day, so they're just going to baptize the day and recall it by a Christian name. And especially if they can find a Christian theme which coincides with the same type of festivities. Because festivities, there's nothing wrong with them, as long as you order them towards God. You'll find that Helena goes to the Holy Land parts, bringing back the relics. You'll also find at this time the popularization of pilgrimages. Everyone's going to see the Queen Mother going on this pilgrimage to the Holy Land. People are going to want to walk in the footsteps of what the Queen is doing. Not dissimilar from people who want to walk in the footsteps of our common movie stars and things like that, and they do want to do everything that they do. People are still haven't changed really all that much. So you're going to see the popularization of pilgrimage routes as well as looking at relics again, but this isn't going to be first time because we have this going back all the way to 162 to Polycarp, where Polycarp was martyred. Helen, which is why you can still go to St. Peter's Basilica today and you can see that the statue of Helen is right there around the altar. There's four of them. There's the statue of Helena, the statue of Longinus with the spear, where you still have the spear of Longinus, the spear which was pierced in the side of Christ, which is underneath that. That spear only comes out, I was very upset, because I really wanted to see that spear, but it only comes out on Christmas, which I've never been to Rome on Christmas. So you can only go a couple times a year to see these relics that are underneath these huge statues which surround the baldacchini, the big black one done by Bernini, which goes over the high altar. But you'll find Helena, you'll find Longinus, you'll find John the Baptist, and the fourth one's eluding me. But so Polycarp, going back. Constantine will again start assimilating them by baptizing all the different traditions. He'll also, in 337, so just a few short years after the, and this is right before, shortly before his death, is that Constantine will abolish crucifixion throughout the empire. In reverence and in honor of Christ, he will no longer allow crucifixion as a capital punishment to be used in capital offense cases. He doesn't abolish capital punishment. Constantine is pretty brutal when it comes down to violations of the law. He actually kills a couple members of his own family for things of where they violate different ethical norms. But Constantine will abolish crucifixion, which will actually give rise very quickly, because you won't see crucifixes or crosses used in the early church, because it was a sign of horror. But actually what we'll find is that after Constantine abolishes, you're going to see the rise of the use of the crucifix as well as crosses in Christian art, as well as people wearing them and relics and things of this nature, especially when the true cross comes back from Israel, is that you're going to have this great rise in veneration of crucifixes and crosses. Also because people are not constantly seeing people die on crosses anymore. As people become desensitized to the horror of crucifixion, people no longer see it as a common means of execution on roadways because Constantine makes it illegal. Now you're going to see the rise of crucifixes and crosses as becoming main signs of Christianity. You're going to find them in churches, you're going to find them in all these different things, but prior to this, you'll never see, for the most part, a cross or a crucifix used in art or in decoration, things like this. So Constantine will eliminate the rule of four. He will go back to the sole rule, sole Augustus. And he will build a major city. He will build the city of Constantine, which will eventually be called Constantinople. And he will build it at the straits in Turkey, controlling those pivotal trade routes by sea and by land in Turkey. And he will actually move the capital to Constantinople. And so this is a big, because this is also going to show a gradual shift in terms of the church. Because when he moves the capital to Constantinople and dedicates it in 330, this becomes, when he also moves there, this becomes, although not legally speaking, Rome is still the legal capital of the empire, but where the emperor is, where the sole Augustus is, this is the ruling city. And so you're going to see this gradual political shift over away from Rome to Constantinople. You're also going to see that Constantine will then start pouring huge amounts of money into building Constantinople, building the city of Constantine. And as a result of this, you're going to find this huge political shift away from the West and Rome towards the East. You're also going to see that, for the most part, that in the East, you're going to have much more of a Greek culture and a Greek influence. And you're going to slowly see that in terms of the Roman Empire, it becomes much less Roman in terms of Italian and becomes much more Greek. And thus, you're going to start seeing the rise of what will eventually be called the Byzantine Empire. Because there's sometimes an understanding that when Rome was plundered by barbarians, which we're getting to in just a minute, that Rome fell. Well, yes and no. Rome fell, but Rome was not the Roman Empire. Constantine the Empire, he will also start, he will pay off the Huns to keep moving, allows Constantinople time to build what will become one of the a wonder of the ancient world, which is the walls of Constantinople, impregnable. Works of genius, both in terms of how they were built, as well as the structure. And so these will become the main walls that they hide behind, but the West, especially Rome, will not be so lucky. One, they don't have the monies, they don't have the ability to build the fortifications and rebuild the fortifications of Rome. So the seat of the Roman Empire moved to Constantinople, you're going to see that the East will flourish, both militarily as well as economically, and you're going to find a gradual decline in most of the West, especially as monies are moved, especially out of some of the far-reaching territories like England and Gaul and things like that, and it's moved more centrally to Turkey, as well as into the parts of the Middle East and things like this. You're going to find much more of a centralization of power in Turkey. So But everything, for the most part, there still is only going to be one branch, one Christian denomination, which is all the Christians who are Nicene Christians. And so all these Nicene Christians, you will always have little pockets of people popping up here and there, but those communities will not survive. With the exception of actually the Arians. And the Arians will survive. And the Arians will survive for one very important reason, is that during this time where the West, also you're going to find the building of the Hagia Sophia, in the West you'll find, though, that Rome will lose much of its power and will eventually be sacked by the Goths. But during this time, you're going to find that one of the reasons for the sacking is that you're going to find that no longer is really even the, they're going to be have a kind of a head of the West. There'll be a head, an emperor, but he will very shortly lose power, and he will become, for the most part, de facto non-existent. You won't have troops in the West. There's only actually going to be one central unifying figure in the West for civilization in the West. Only one figure who's holding anything together of any type of civilization whatsoever, and that's the patron of the poor. Because the people who are in the West were the poor, and they're getting poorer and poorer, especially with this advent of barbarians as they're flooding through and sacking, is that you're going to find that the Pope becomes the central figure in the West who's keeping any resemblance of Roman civilization together. At least in terms of, maybe not politically or militarily, but in terms of a central figure that people can look to as a stable leader. Because the leadership in the West is going to be, there's going to be leaders that pop up in the West in terms of Rome and things like this, but there's not going to be any stable leadership. There's only going to be one consistent, stable leader in terms of a person who's constantly there, constantly in the lives of the people, and that's going to be the Holy Father in Rome. And people are actually going to flock and gather around this, especially as you're going to find that the Huns are pushing the Visigoths, the Ostrogoths. And one of the problems that we'll have with the advent of the Goths is that Rome, which is unable to defend against it, is that the Goths will also start meeting Arian missionaries. The Arians will actually go to the Goths and will have great success in converting the Arians to Arian Christianity. But this is going to be a problem for Nicene Christians who are already there. So the Goths are going to come in. You're going to have Arius, this guy by the name of Wolfred, who will go in. Behind them is, again, Attila the Hun. Attila the Hun is pushing all these things. And that's where you're going to have major battles between Goths and Attila. Finally, when the Goths settle in parts of Spain and in Italy, is you're going to have these major conflicts between the Huns, the Romans, and the forces of the Goths. So during this time, you're also going to find that eventually when Attila shows up at the gates, again, if you can read the story of Attila, it's much more complex than just he's a barbarian who comes across, because one of the main ways in which the Roman Empire would actually make peace is that they would pay you a lot of money, whether they pay the barbarians a lot of money, and in return, the barbarians would have to keep moving, and they'd have to send one or two of their firstborn sons from their leading commanders or their king would have to go and stay with the Romans as hostages. But the hostages would be kept and would be kept in very nice conditions, and they'd be raised as Romans, they'd be educated, and so this was a way of the Romans. And the Romans have been doing this for a long time. They've done this with the Germans, they've done this with, and they will do the same thing. Attila is actually one of these hostages. Attila was raised in Rome, so he had this very much this Roman influence. He will go back to his people after a period of time, and you'll have the same thing will happen in Germany. You're going to have in Germany, northern Germany, you'll have the same thing. These hostages who go home, they go home, they see what's happened to their people, and they will want to bring their people. And Attila will actually be, for the most part, camped out until this princess, this Italian princess, doesn't get what she wants, and she will send a letter seeking actually the hand of Attila, and she says, "I will give you Italy if you come in and save me." But it's very much political intrigue at the time of what's going on. And Attila will come across and basically will use this as a justification for invading Italy and for invading all these things. So Attila, when he shows up, it will be actually the Pope who will go outside, and he will go out and make this plea with Attila. During this time where he will go out and he will make this plea, supposedly Attila will see in the sky, he'll have this vision, because without any explanation, Attila the Hun will come up to Rome with every intention of military conquering. There's nothing which is stopping him from conquering all of Italy. He will come up, and that Innocent will come out, the Pope will come out, will have a private meeting with Attila outside of Rome, and Attila will pack up and leave. And then he'll die the following year, and the Huns will disperse throughout Europe. Many of them will end up in modern-day Hungary. But as a result of this, no one really knows what happens at then. There's a lot of speculation, a lot of skepticism on what happened. But according to tradition, what will happen is that Attila was told basically by the Pope that God is protecting Rome, and he sees in the sky this image of Peter and Paul bearing swords. It'll scare the crap out of him. And actually, the Huns were, for the most part, very superstitious. And for whatever reason, we know by history that he will meet with the Pope. The Pope will come out as the one person who can speak for all the people of Rome, especially for the poor, and he is the patron of the poor, and that's what gives him any justification, because the Pope also doesn't have any military might, and for the most part, he doesn't have a lot of financial might or economic might, but he does have the populist might. So this patronage system, when the Pope starts especially start exerting power of protection, you're going to see this shift in patronage, especially among the masses. Because if wherever you, whoever your patron was, you had an obligation by society, and this goes back to the ancient Greek, you were obliged to offer them loyalty. And actually, it was also recognized in the ancient world. You betrayed your patron, you betrayed a friend. It was one of the most evil of all crimes, was the violations of these things. So actually, the people will start seeing the Pope much more as a, not just a spiritual leader, but also a temporal leader, if this makes sense. And things like that, you're going to see all the different movements of, you're going to find Vandals who will end up in North Africa. The Vandals will also convert in mass to Arian Christianity. You're going to find that the Goths being pushed by the Huns will end up going this way. You'll have a split where some will go into Spain. You'll find some end up in Italy. The Huns will end up here. You'll have major battles up here. And you'll have, obviously, the Saxons, the Jutes, and all the Angles, which are over there in the Great Britain area. But during this time, you're going to find that the church, this is later barbarian invasions, as you have all these movements, these massive movements of peoples, they don't have borders, they can't protect their borders, and so you just have these mass advents of peoples across borders as you have what's considered the Dark Ages. Leo the Great will be the Bishop of Rome. He'll be the one who will go out and meet with Attila in 461. You're going to have, though, that the Goths will consistently sack it twice, but who they will meet will be these Arian bishops. And so these Goths, these Gothic tribes, as well as these Vandal tribes, and all these different ones, there is a religious difference between many of them. They are united in Arian Christianity. And for the most part, Christian missionaries will go out to many of these barbarian tribes for two reasons. One, to spread the gospel, which was obviously a major tenet of what Jesus tells, go out and convert all nations. It also, though, has a very practical implication. If you can convert all of these massive people coming into your territory, you can convert them to the one faith. You have nothing militarily to offer them or to stand against them. You also have nothing. They're just going to pillage you. But if you can convert them to the same faith, especially a faith which obliges them to be kind and merciful, you are more likely to live. So actually converting the pagans and converting the barbarians becomes a point of necessity for the survivors of people in the West. They must convert them. And the Arians will do it first. But you also find that this idea of patronage will be a major reality, a cultural reality which is going on. So as you have all these people converting in mass, they're going to be loyal to the particular person that they have converted to. So therefore, they'll be loyal to Arian bishops, or they'll be loyal to Nicene bishops. This is a painting of the confrontation between Leo and the Pope. There's Leo. There's Attila, where is he? Falling from the horse, I believe. And then you have Peter and Paul, who are up here. Actually, I can't find Attila. Here's Attila, right here, looking up and seeing, in terms of the artwork. So you can see this in the Vatican, even to this day. Here's a breeze of Attila meeting Leo, and this will be a major point of power. So the church will, again, have this twofold purpose of converting them, and also this entails the survival of both Christians in the West as well as civilization in the West. You're also going to see during this time the rise of monasteries. Now, you're going to find the monastic life is going to be all the way back to the second century. You'll find people called the Desert Fathers, these guys who had fled off into the desert to live ascetical lives, very much like the Essenes to the Jews, going back to the Jews. You'll find these Desert Fathers who will grow up in these communities. You'll have these communities which grow up in the desert. And so actually monasteries will become major centers of civilization where people can gather, because monasteries also typically had walls. So as soon as you had bunches of barbarians who were coming in, or you had raiding parties, everyone flees into the nearest area, which had walls that you could protect. And so monasteries will become little centers, little bastions of light. Both light in terms of education, because there's also education going on in monasteries, and you can get both teachings in the faith as well as basic education in terms of various things. But there'll also be beacons where you can survive. And that's why that you'll have church bells. Everyone flees. If you have a monastery, you go. If your village, because for the most part, most villages didn't have a lot of walls, or if they had walls, it was palisades, wooden sticks, which is not going to keep barbarians out for very long. So you'll find that St. Augustine of Canterbury will end up being sent as a missionary into England at this time, and he will have great success in England. You'll find that the Saxons, eventually in the Irish, you'll find that Augustine will go there. Patrick will end up, obviously, in Ireland. You'll find Boniface will go to the Teutons and to the Germans. This is why Boniface actually will get martyred. It's for cutting down one of their sacred trees. And he will be martyred as account of this. It's actually, if you think about it in today's society, if he went down and if actually any priest went to some place and cut down a tree, we'd probably be reprimanded. But Boniface was made a martyr for cutting down this sign of paganism. Boniface will go into Germany. You'll find lots of different missionaries who will end up in various places. You'll find Patrick, obviously, as most people will know, will go to the Celts in Ireland. And actually, the more spiritual a culture was, the harder it was for them to be converted. You'll also find that the more vagrant a people were, the more likely they were to convert. Because people who were connected to their land and were still in their same lands were less inclined to convert to Christianity. It's one of the reasons why Patrick was the first person to have success with the Celts. Because for the most part, they were not moving, and they had not been moved. The same thing with the Vikings. The Vikings, for the most part, they have a very difficult time converting Vikings because they're still connected to their land. But all these different people who are dispossessed from their lands and movement, it also is an association with their gods. You could also say that it's more likely that they will view that their gods have abandoned them, which is why they are moving, so they're more likely to accept Christianity. And that's why you will find much in terms of all the movements of the barbarian tribes, you'll find the ones that are constantly in movement will have great success. And the structure of tribal barbarian society, all that you had to do as a missionary was you had to convince their leader. If you got their leader, then the whole rest of the tribe would convert. And this was the mass practice. Because all of their leaders were in oaths of fidelity. All the different barons or the different warlords and things like this would be have loyalty to their one leader. Whatever their leader did, that's what they did. So when you went and converted one major leader of the Goths, you had an entire tribe. And so that's actually what it becomes, is a competition to see how many you can get. It's the empire. He will also start, he will pay off the Huns to keep moving, allows Constantinople time to build what will become one of the a wonder of the ancient world, which is the walls of Constantinople, impregnable. Works of genius, both in terms of how they were built, as well as the structure. And so these will become the main walls that they hide behind, but the West, especially Rome, will not be so lucky. One, they don't have the monies, they don't have the ability to build the fortifications and rebuild the fortifications of Rome. So the seat of the Roman Empire moved to Constantinople. You're going to see that the East will flourish, both militarily as well as economically, and you're going to find a gradual decline in most of the West. Especially as monies are moved, especially out of some of the far-reaching territories like England and Gaul and things like that, and it's moved more centrally to Turkey, as well as into parts of the Middle East and things like this. You're going to find much more of a centralization of power in Turkey. So, but everything for the most part, there still is only going to be one branch, one Christian denomination, which is all the Christians who are Nicene Christians. And so all these Nicene Christians, you will always have little pockets of people popping up here and there, but those communities will not survive. With the exception of actually the Arians. And the Arians will survive. And the Arians will survive for one very important reason, is that during this time where the West, also you're going to find the building of the Hagia Sophia. In the West, you'll find, though, that Rome will lose much of its power and will eventually be sacked by the Goths. But during this time, you're going to find that one of the reasons for the sacking is that you're going to find that no longer is really even they're going to have a kind of a head of the West. There'll be a head, an emperor, but he will very shortly lose power, and he will become, for the most part, de facto non-existent. You won't have troops in the West. There's only actually going to be one central unifying figure in the West for civilization in the West. Only one figure who's holding anything together of any type of civilization whatsoever, and that's the patron of the poor. Because the people who are in the West were the poor, And they're getting poorer and poorer, especially with this advent of barbarians as they're flooding through and sacking, is that you're going to find that the Pope becomes the central figure in the West who's keeping any resemblance of Roman civilization together, at least in terms of maybe not politically or militarily, but in terms of a central figure that people can look to as a stable leader. Because the leadership in the West is going to be, there's going to be leaders that pop up in the West in terms of Rome and things like this, but there's not going to be any stable leadership. There's only going to be one consistent, stable leader in terms of a person who's constantly there, constantly in the lives of the people, and that's going to be the Holy Father in Rome. And people are actually going to gather around this, especially as you're going to find that the Huns are pushing the Visigoths, the Ostrogoths. And one of the problems that we'll have with the advent of the Goths is that Rome, which is unable to defend against it, is that the Goths will also start meeting Arian missionaries. The Arians will actually go to the Goths and will have great success in converting the Arians to Arian Christianity. But this is going to be a problem for Nicene Christians who are already there. So the Goths are going to come in. You're going to have Arius, this guy by the name of Wolfred, who will go in. Behind them is, again, Attila the Hun. Attila the Hun is pushing all these things. And that's where you're going to have major battles between Goths and Attila. Finally, when the Goths settle in parts of Spain and in Italy, is you're going to have these major conflicts between the Huns, the Romans, and the forces of the Goths. So during this time, you're also going to find that eventually when Attila shows up at the gates, again, if you can read the story of Attila, it's much more complex than just he's a barbarian who comes across. Because one of the main ways in which the Roman Empire would actually make peace is that they would pay you a lot of money, whether they pay the barbarians a lot of money, and in return, the barbarians would have to keep moving, and they'd have to send one or two of their firstborn sons from their leading commanders or their king would have to go and stay with the Romans as hostages. But the hostages would be kept and would be kept in very nice conditions, and they'd be raised as Romans, they'd be educated, and so this was a way of the Romans. And the Romans have been doing this for a long time. They've done this with the Germans, they've done this with, and they will do the same thing. Attila is actually one of these hostages. Attila was raised in Rome, so he had this very much this Roman influence. He will go back to his people after a period of time, and you'll have the same thing will happen in Germany. You're going to have in Germany, northern Germany, you'll have the same thing. These hostages who go home, they go home, they see what's happened to their people, and they will want to bring their people. And Attila will actually be, for the most part, camped out until this princess, this Italian princess, doesn't get what she wants, and she will send a letter seeking actually the hand of Attila, and she says, "I will give you Italy if you come in and save me." But it's very much political intrigue at the time of what's going on. And Attila will come across and basically will use this as a justification for invading Italy and for invading all these things. So Attila, when he shows up, it will be actually the Pope who will go outside, and he will go out and make this plea with Attila. During this time where he will go out and he will make this plea, supposedly Attila will see in the sky, he'll have this vision, because without any explanation, Attila the Hun will come up to Rome with every intention of military conquering. There's nothing which is stopping him from conquering all of Italy. He will come up, and that Innocent will come out, the Pope will come out, will have a private meeting with Attila outside of Rome, and Attila will pack up and leave. And then he'll die the following year, and the Huns will disperse throughout Europe. Many of them will end up in modern-day Hungary. But as a result of this, no one really knows what happens at then. There's a lot of speculation, a lot of skepticism on what happened. But according to tradition, what will happen is that Attila was told basically by the Pope that God is protecting Rome, and he sees in the sky this image of Peter and Paul bearing swords. It'll scare the crap out of him. And actually, the Huns were, for the most part, very superstitious. And for whatever reason, we know by history that he will meet with the Pope. The Pope will come out as the one person who can speak for all the people of Rome, especially for the poor, and he is the patron of the poor, and that's what gives him any justification, because the Pope also doesn't have any military might, and for the most part, he doesn't have a lot of financial might or economic might, but he does have the populist might. So this patronage system, when the Pope starts especially start exerting power of protection, you're going to see this shift in patronage, especially among the masses, because whoever your patron was, you had an obligation by society, and this goes back to the ancient Greek, you were obliged to offer them loyalty. And actually, it was also recognized in the ancient world. You betrayed your patron, you betrayed a friend. It was one of the most evil of all crimes, was the violations of these things. So actually, the people will start seeing the Pope much more as a not just a spiritual leader, but also a temporal leader, if this makes sense. And things like that, you're going to see all the different movements of, you're going to find Vandals who will end up in North Africa. The Vandals will also convert in mass to Arian Christianity. You're going to find that the Goths being pushed by the Huns will end up going this way. You'll have a split where some will go into Spain. You'll find some end up in Italy. The Huns will end up here. You'll have major battles up here. And you'll have, obviously, the Saxons, the Jutes, and all the Angles, which are over there in the Great Britain area. But during this time, you're going to find that the church, this is later barbarian invasions, as you have all these movements, these massive movements of peoples, they don't have borders, they can't protect their borders, and so you just have these mass advents of peoples across borders as you have what's considered the Dark Ages. Leo the Great will be the Bishop of Rome. He'll be the one who will go out and meet with Attila in 461. You're going to have, though, that the Goths will consistently sack it twice, but who they will meet will be these Arian bishops. And so these Goths, these Gothic tribes, as well as these Vandal tribes, and all these different ones, there is a religious difference between many of them. They are united in Arian Christianity. And for the most part, Christian missionaries will go out to many of these barbarian tribes for two reasons. One, to spread the gospel, which was obviously a major tenet of what Jesus tells, go out and convert all nations. It also, though, has a very practical implication. If you can convert all of these massive people coming into your territory, you can convert them to the one faith. You have nothing militarily to offer them or to stand against them. You also have nothing, they're just going to pillage you. But if you can convert them to the same faith, especially a faith which obliges them to be kind and merciful, you are more likely to live. So actually converting the pagans and converting the barbarians becomes a point of necessity for the survivors of people in the West. They must convert them. And the Arians will do it first. But you also find that this idea of patronage will be a major reality, a cultural reality which is going on. So as you have all these people converting in mass, they're going to be loyal to the particular person that they have converted to. So therefore they'll be loyal to Arian bishops, or they'll be loyal to Nicene bishops. This is a painting of the confrontation between Leo and the Pope. There's Leo, there's Attila, where is he? Falling from the horse, I believe. And then you have Peter and Paul, who are up here. Actually, I can't find Attila. Here's Attila, right here, looking up and seeing, in terms of the artwork. So you can see this in the Vatican, even to this day. Here's a breeze of Attila meeting Leo, and this will be a major point of power. So the church will again have this twofold purpose of converting them, and also this entails the survival of both Christians in the West as well as civilization in the West. You're also going to see during this time the rise of monasteries. Now you're going to find the monastic life is going to be all the way back to the second century. You'll find people called the Desert Fathers, these guys who had fled off into the desert to live ascetical lives, very much like the Essenes to the Jews, going back to the Jews. You'll find these Desert Fathers who will grow up in these communities. You'll have these communities which grow up in the desert. And so actually monasteries will become major centers of civilization where people can gather, because monasteries also typically had walls. So as soon as you had bunches of barbarians who were coming in, or you had raiding parties, everyone flees into the nearest area, which had walls that you could protect. And so monasteries will become little centers, little bastions of light. Both light in terms of education, because there's also education going on in monasteries, and you can get both teachings in the faith as well as basic education in terms of various things, but there'll also be beacons where you can survive. And that's why that you'll have church bells, everyone flees. If you have a monastery, you go. If your village, because for the most part, most villages didn't have a lot of walls, or if they had walls, it was palisades, wooden sticks, which is not going to keep barbarians out for very long. So you'll find that St. Augustine of Canterbury will end up being sent as a missionary into England at this time, and he will have great success in England. You'll find that the Saxons, eventually in the Irish, you'll find that Augustine will go there. Patrick will end up obviously in Ireland. You'll find Boniface will go to the Teutons. Kind of looks the same basically, but a lot of people have different customs, different ways of saying it, different languages, things like that. What you'll find in 590 is you'll find this centralization of power and the centralization of the church when Gregory will enact what's called the Gregorian Reforms. As a result of this, if you have a custom which goes back several hundred years, you'll be allowed to keep it. But if you have just your own customs, as they've been going on along, everyone has to adopt the same mass. You have to adopt the same mass. You have to adopt the same language. You have to adopt the same prayers. You have to adopt, for the most part, there's a lot of fluidity in terms of the mass. The structure was always the same. Liturgy of the Word, Liturgy of the Eucharist, the consecration prayers and things like this. But there's a lot of variance, differences. So what will happen, though, during the Gregorian forms is that the mass will become centralized. And therefore, everyone starts doing the same thing. A lot of people don't like this. But therefore, the ones who are ancient, that can trace themselves back to the ancient church, like the first, second centuries, they will be permitted to allow to continue with their liturgies, but they cannot expand them. Therefore, you'll actually have the creation of various rites. So you'll have like the rites of the ancient masses said in Spain, or the rites of the ancient various places, but they're not allowed to expand. The only thing which can expand into new territories is the Gregorian mass, or the Gregorian mass. So it doesn't seem like it's that big of a deal at the time, but in terms of the centralization of the church, as well as making all people one in faith and things like this, and a reason for this is, again, because he's recognizing with all the advent of all these barbarians, sometimes people think, well, again, that he's kind of this nefarious trying to centralize power. For the most part, there's a very practical reason for all this, is that there's chaos, which is happening at masses and things like this. People are trying to go to different places. They don't understand it. It's all in these different languages. So they decide, no, it needs to be in one language. It needs to be pretty much looking the same across the board. Does this make sense? Mm-hmm. But the fundamentals of the mass have always looked the same. But in terms of some of those distinctions, and even to this day, the church will allow for certain customs to grow, but those customs have to be longstanding. If they're not, then they're considered to be kind of not what the liturgy is really designed for. So he enacts the major liturgical reform, which might not seem important, but again, this major consolidation of papal power in the Catholic Church, though, acts on a century-wide scale, not on a decade scale. So they don't even see the action of this really until a really wide scale takes place. And this is where you're going to start seeing Gregorian chant. Things like this will arise, Gregorian chant, as well as a uniform mass, which will come out of this. This is also when Gregory will send Augustine to England, and you'll have Augustine of Canterbury will have great advances. So during this, the semi-spiritual barbarians, the ones who are moving, will, for the most part, become Arians. The Goths, the Visigoths, the Ostrogoths in Italy, the Vandals, who will end up in Northern Europe. But for the most part, all of these different tribes, because of their location on the map, will be crushed. They'll be crushed from the Byzantines from the east, who have no tolerance for this, especially because they're Arians. You'll find that they are crushed militarily by the Franks from the north. And then what you'll find in the 5th century is the rise of Islam. And especially with the rise of Islam, you'll find that all these areas of Arian Christianity will pretty much be annihilated. And they will be, the pockets that survive will be absorbed into Nicene Christianity. So the Huns, for the most part, didn't really, again, they were militarily, but they didn't have too much of a strong spirituality, at least not the one that was lasting. The Saxons, and then you'll have the Franks. So, going back to this principle, the ones who are connected much more to the land and likewise have not been moving around, they're going to have much more difficulty converting peoples like the Celts or the Vikings or the Norse, people of that. So with the Druids, it'll especially get nasty. The Vikings, you'll always find that it gets nasty, this conflict between Vikings and Christians, because also Vikings, for the most part, were very warlike but very honorable. And so this idea of death and battle, the Valkyries and things like this, so this idea of sacrificing yourself and allowing people to kill you is not going to be very appealing to the Vikings whatsoever. But in the Eastern Empire at the same time, you're going to have this flourishing as well as on the political level as well as the spiritual. A major emperor that happens also during the same time as the rise of Islam and all these different things that are going on is this guy by the name of Justinian. He has a wife by the name of Theodora. Theodora was originally, if I remember correctly, she was a circus performer who he will fall in love with. And he's actually a very effective general who ends up taking over the control of the empire. So he's, for the most part, pretty much kind of secular. He is concerned with some spiritual matters, but he's not too much of a theologian. But his wife is very concerned with theological matters, and she's actually a heretic, or she's what's referred to as a monophyte, a monophysitism. So what will happen is that she will elect the seat of Constantinople, the successor of the Greek church, who is recognized not as being Rome and Peter, but the successor of the Greek church is Andrew, the patriarch of Constantinople. The patriarchship becomes vacant. He dies. So what will happen is she will elect her own man, and he will be established and made the patriarch of Constantinople. But all of the clergy of Constantinople will, the bishop, I mean, when the pope will come on this visit, just to see how things were going on, is that all of the clergy, all of the priests, and all of the very upset people come and tell the Pope. They say, this man is a heretic, and the Empress has placed him on, and you need to depose him. And so actually, that's what will happen, is that he will confront Emperor Justinian and basically say, this has to stop, and you need to take this heretic off, and we need to replace him with someone else. And Justinian will threaten him, which is when you'll get the famous response from Pope Agapetus. He says, I came here to gaze upon the most holy Christian emperor, Justinian. Instead, in his place, I have found a Diocletian, whose threats do not terrify me at all. So, actually, from extreme external pressure, is that Justinian will have to step in and will actually remove him as the Patriarch of Constantinople. And Theodora will be pissed. She would be so upset. And also going to this fact is that there's no set way of electing, there's no like formalized way of electing. The election process was for the most part fairly fluid. And a lot of times the local governors or the local area would have some say in this. So this is not something which is entirely new. But what will happen is that during this time is that she will be very, 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 very upset. And what will actually happen is that she will start to assassinate. She will have Agapetus actually sent off, and he will die. She will send her general Basilius, to go in, because after Agapetus is supposedly killed, is that the bishops of Rome will elect a new pope. And so she will be pushing for her man to be made the pope, and his name is by the name of Vigilius. Vigilius will lose. And Vigilius instead will be replaced, a guy by the name of Silvarius. Silvarius will actually be exiled and will die of starvation on an island after Theodora gets her hands on him. And so for many years, actually, because of the strife between the Eastern Empire in terms of their political government trying to unseat Rome, because she recognized that Rome was causing her not to be able to place her man on the seat of Constantinople. So actually Rome will become, this is Silvarius dies on an island, Vigilius will become what's referred to as the first anti-pope. He will wrest control without a legitimate authority. He will basically take over the Western Church. No one will agree to this until finally, actually after several years, Vigilius will be actually elected as a valid pope, because finally there's so much pressure. And then immediately overnight, Vigilius has a conversion. This is all historically accurate. Immediately overnight, for whatever reason, Vigilius sends a letter to Theodora and says, I will not be participating within any of your plans anymore. I repent for the part I had to play in the death of Agapetus and of Silvarius. And he says, I refuse to participate within any more of your plans. And then Theodora will come after Vigilius. You did a question?
Well, I was going to ask, is this about the time frame when there was the debate or whatever about two different popes, one in Constantinople and one in Rome?
No. This is a little bit different. This one's a different. Right. This is when you have the first real anti-pope. I mean, there's some other ones who claimed it, but this is the first kind of legitimate anti-pope who comes in, who tries wrestling control. But you really see that the anti-pope is coming more from the standpoint of the Eastern Empire empress who's trying to wrestle control of the spiritual. That's where you see kind of the temporal leadership in the East starts to place more of their fingers in the spiritual ruling of the church to try to influence doctrine and dogma. That's what she was trying to do, is to influence, to legitimize monotheism. This is the 500s. This is also the same time, because this is a great expansion because Justinian, in terms of his expansion, he actually expanded the empire larger than it had been in a long time, which is why he comes finally back in contact with the West and they have regular relations. There was relations, but they were irregular during a lot of that. But he's the first stable emperor because he's a military genius. So you have the first stable, but this is also the time where you're having the rise of Islam. And so you have a lot of conflict, and you still have you still have the problems of the Vandals, and you still have the problems of the Goths in terms of the barbarians and in terms of their different religion. Then you'll also have another problem in the East is what's referred to as the iconoclastic period. The iconoclastic period was basically a fundamentalism that had infected the Eastern Empire, that for a long time icons were very, very important in the Eastern Empire. And so the understanding of icons and their way of praying and their way of entering a person more deeply into prayer is that people started looking at icons and very simply said, well, these are idols. These are false idols. These are people who are praying to statues. We're praying to things like this. And so the iconoclastic period, which was actually even headed at times by the emperor of Constantinople, what they will actually start going in, they'll start going in, they'll go into monasteries, they'll go into churches, and they'll start destroying ancient icons. And I don't know if anyone knows any Greek Orthodox, their most sacred things that they have, apart from the Eucharist and the sacraments, are their icons. Because these are the manifestations of their prayer. These are actually their prayers and things that go into this. So this becomes a major spiritual division that happens in the Eastern Empire, this fundamentalism of these people who are saying that this is idolatry. What will happen, though, after several emperors will go, is that you'll finally have a female who will take over the Eastern Empire, and she will basically condemn this. It was pretty, for the most part, it's actually many of the male emperors, Leo and things like this, who will be very iconoclastic. They'll be about destroying all these things. It also simplifies things in terms of wrestling control if you want more control over the church. But it will actually be this woman by the name of Irene, Empress Irene, who will come and say, no, this is wrong. And it will be the females who will actually much more, the empresses who later on in the 7th century, who will be much more in support of the icons and things like this. As to the, even to the point where finally they will have a council, several councils, which Irene will ask for the Pope for his help in convening this council and legitimizing it because there's such strife. He will do so, and they will condemn the iconoclastic movement in two different councils. But Irene, again, Gregory the Third will hold two synods in Rome, condemning Leo, who's the emperor at the time, who in response will also start confiscating papal lands. It's also important to recognize the papal lands. You'll find the rise of the papal states. As soon as Pepin is made the new king of the Carolingian Empire, dynasty of the Franks, as a favor and as a gift, he will then give lands to the Pope. And you'll find the creation of the papal states. So these are the what is actually, you'll find the growth in the papal states, and so the growth in lands, because the church, sometimes it's important to recognize that the church, people also when they're leaving things and they're dying, more often than not, many people will leave things to the church for helping the poor, for the just this church and things like that. So over a period of 10, 15 years, you're not going to acquire a lot. Over a period of several hundred, you're going to start acquiring a lot of land. And land produces taxes. Land produces money. Land produces these things. So the church starts to grow wealthy. So any time that you upset the local governor or the local king or the emperor would start coming in and taking land. So in response to this, the emperor will actually come in and take lands from the Pope. So finally, the iconoclastic period will come to an end, as well as the 7th. They will try to re-legitimize it by the 7th Council, but its legitimacy is completely disregarded. You're going to have the Constantinople is going to be vacant for a while Alexandria, Jerusalem, and Antioch by this time are in Muslim control, Muslim hands. So really the only two ancient cities in the world which are still existing by the 7th century that are still is Rome and Constantinople. So you're going to see the falling away of Alexandria because the Muslims will come up and will conquer Egypt, the Berber Muslims and things like this. You'll find that they'll take over Israel. So therefore, Jerusalem will cease to exist as a bed of Christianity. And then you'll find, even in Antioch, you'll find in Turkey as the rise of Islam and things like that, you'll find the loss of many of these things. And that's why constantly the Byzantines will try and should be going out and reconquer lost lands to the Muslims. And so there'll be constant warfare with Muslim forces and the Byzantine forces for hundreds of years. So finally, you'll get into 780, is that you'll have a major event which will happen is that Constantine the VI, who is a young boy, but is minor, his mother, Irene, who is instrumental behind these two councils, which will condemn the iconoclastic period, is that she will basically become the de facto head of the Eastern Empire. And as a result, she will actually, at one point, she will send and try to make envoys to make a creation with a pact with Charlemagne, where she will even go to overtures of marrying her daughter to Charlemagne. It doesn't work out. Trying to create a stronger pact. What will eventually happen, though, is that she will have many problems in terms of her younger son. Because when her younger son comes of age, he will be a little bit unhinged, and he will want to rule the empire. And Irene won't let him. She will say, no, we will rule it together, mommy and son. So not only is the son slightly unhinged and quite brutal, but he wants nothing to do with his mother. And so he will actually try to throw a coup of Irene during this time. Let's see if I can get to the picture. The last iconoclastic period will be later on, about 70 years later, which will be the lasting. But finally, Irene will put down the coup, will blind her son, and will take complete control over the Eastern Empire. Because if you blinded someone, they were illegitimate to become the emperor. So she will blind him, and she will take complete control over the of the Eastern Empire. But this will cause major problems, because it'll be problems because at that time it was understood that this was an illegitimate action. She is an illegitimate person to stand on the throne, and therefore you will have something which will happen in 800 with Charlemagne. Before we get to that though, the iconoclastic period will also lead to the rise in this understanding of even where we have today, the understanding of what we refer to as adoration and worship. In the ancient Greek world, there's two words for worship, because then the question becomes, do Catholics worship relics, or do they worship Mary, or do they worship all these different things? But in Greek, there's two different words for worship. There's what's referred to as dulia, and there's what's referred to as latreia. Dulia is the type of worship that you give to an athlete, and this is where it will develop, is especially during these various times, especially as you're having all these accusations of idolatry. Are these things actually idolatrous? And you'll have also the rise of various Marian dogmas during this time as well. So the understanding of worship is that we understand that dulia is the type of worship that you give to a human being that you want to be like because you admire that they are they have excellence in a particular field. And so Mary, as well as relics and things like this, is what we give what's referred to as dulia in Greek. The other type of worship is the worship of latreia. Latreia, which was recognized as being worship of the gods, or which was given to God and to God alone. So there's two different types. So but in English we only have one word for worship, and so this becomes the formulation where you start seeing the development of especially Marian dogmas and this understanding of, well, what does it mean that when we venerate things versus when we worship things? Because actually the word veneration is much more closely associated with admiration or dulia versus latreia, which is offered to God and to God alone. Yes? Were you just waving, or do you have a question?
I was wondering,
okay. So, latreia, which is given to God and God alone, this is where you'll find also the reasoning which will go behind that. Know that venerating the saints, venerating Mary, having relics, having icons, these things are not idolatrous, because you're going to have the distinction of this separation between the two terms, which was always present even in the ancient world. That's why when they would worship the Greek athletes in the ancient world in Greece, in the pagan world, they understood that this was not the same type of worship that they did when they were in pagan temples. And so the Christians will adopt the same type of language to use this separation between the two terms, and that's why we would say that we're not idolatrous and not falling into the sin of idolatry. Because we also recognize that authentic dulia gives glory not to the object, but to the maker of the object. And God made Mary. The only reason why Mary is who she is because God made her that way. So when we give dulia, it's like when you recognize a beautiful painting and you say, that's admirable, I wish I could be like that, or I could have that quality which exists there. But you're not giving the worship to the painting, you're giving it to the creator of the painting. So the justification which comes in for the understanding of Mary. But going back to Irene and Constantine, mommy and son will not get along, so he will try to throw a coup or she will blind him. As a result of this, she will take sole control of the empire, and at the same time, the Pope is having problems in Rome. So Clovis is no longer the king. You have now the Carolingian Empire, and the Franks are paying off big, because as the Christians are being successful, you're also going to have the rise of papal power, because Pepin will give much of the land which exists that he has control of in Italy to the Pope, and the Pope will become what's referred to as the Papal States. You'll have Charles Martel, who will have a huge victory down in southern France over the Muslims who are trying to come up through Spain. And he will come down and close down and have a huge victory over the Muslims, which will kind of stop the advent of Islam into Europe. And Islam will therefore be stopping in Spain. And you'll have this constant battle as Muslims and Christians are constantly pushing each other back and forth within Spain. But the Franks, and that's actually why even Muslims for hundreds of years after, because of the battle which happens down in southern France, is that the Muslims will call all Europeans Franks as recognition of the prowess of the Frankish warriors. So what will happen, though, is that Charles Martel's son will become Charles, or Charlemagne, Charles the Great. The Pope will get in trouble with various people And his political enemies in Rome will actually try to kill the Pope and try to blind him and try to mutilate him. And he will actually flee, and he'll flee to Charlemagne. Charlemagne will come back and hold a trial in Rome and actually will find that what had been accused of the Pope is all false. And as a favor, or what will happen is that as a result of this, Pope's enemies will be exiled out of Rome. And the following day on Christmas morning, in favor, also using the illegitimacy of Irene, is that the Pope will say, well, the authority in the East is no longer present, and I am kingmaker. So, I mean, he doesn't say this literally, but basically what he does, he will use the illegitimacy of Irene to basically crown Charlemagne as the king of the entire Roman Empire. So he will delegitimize, or the Pope will attempt to delegitimize Eastern power. It's not successful in the East from their perspective. But in terms of now you have two competing claimants to the Holy Roman Empire. Now, it's no longer just a rule of two, the way it was understood. Now you have a person, the Franks, the Frankish King Charlemagne, as well as his successors, who will claim to be the legitimate heir to the Holy Roman Empire. And then you'll still have, obviously, all the different political intrigue which is going on in the Byzantine with whoever their current emperor is. But you're going to find that this is going to be a major dividing line between East and West in terms of who they recognize as being legitimate authority. Does this make sense? So you find this gradual growth, although in terms of faith, in terms of dogmas and doctrines, you're not going to find any difference at this point, although maybe in particular cases, little things here and there, you're not going to find anything in a spiritual sense which is going to distinguish the religion from the East from the religion of the West. But in terms of the political as well as the economic forces, you're going to find a very strong, growing, gradual divide, especially as Charlemagne brings about a renaissance or a type of renaissance within Europe as he starts creating universities, as he starts creating and the society starts flourishing, you find this rise of money and this rise of prosperity. And so now you have a real legitimate competition to the East under Charlemagne's reign. And actually Charlemagne and the Franks and the Popes are going to be best buddies. They're going to be actually very, very close, relying upon each other. 799, this is where Pope Leo III will flee Rome after they try to gouge at his eyes and rip out his tongue. And then in December of 800, Leo will be found innocent, and therefore you will then have the crowning of Charlemagne, which will be a major point of contention now between East and West. Supposedly he does this without Charlemagne's approval. He just kind of does this. We don't really know. A lot of speculation. But still, for centuries afterwards, you're going to have competing emperors who are going to be claiming total sovereignty over both empires, and you're going to have people who are going to use this as a justification for various actions. So this is the real beginning of the medieval period, because this is where you find the reflowering of Western Europe in terms of culture, wealth, and power. You'll find that the rise of monasteries also become even stronger. You'll find that books and education under Charlemagne and his best friend, a cleric, a monk by the name of Alcuin, who starts, again, being kind of the intellectual genius behind much of Charlemagne's empire, is also his tutor. You'll find the rise of education as well as kind of feudal power will really start to evolve and develop out of this time, but feudal power, which is dependent upon the Pope, as opposed to in the East, the physical authority of the temporal leadership is not dependent upon spiritual reality at all. So you have a rise difference in culture in terms of feudalism, that they look to the Pope as their ultimate head, versus in the West they still look to the emperor as their head. Yes?
Is it true that Charlemagne was illiterate originally when he took over, and this, you said things about the tutor?
I'm not sure on that. So this will lead to, finally, the Great Schism. This is kind of where we'll end. So if you're, what time is it? Is it 9?
9.
Okay. All right, let's see how fast I can get through this. So the Great Schism, you're going to have, I am getting to the end, don't worry. You'll have the barrier of language, because in the East, you're going to have a language barrier between East and West, between Latin and Greek, cultural barrier. In the West, it's going to be very blunt, very in your face, very aggressive, versus in the West, it's going to be very much more diplomatic and subtle, going back to that old Roman. You're going to find ethnicity. You're going to have a Greek culture in the East versus a barbarian melting pot in the West. The values, you're going to have a lot of, actually the word bureaucracy, bureau comes from the Greek, the Byzantine Empire. So a lot of bureaucracy as well as corruption.
that's going to happen in the East versus much more of a tribal and feudal values, which are going to be present in the West. You'll have popes who are interjecting into physical matters in the West versus imperials who are injecting into spiritual matters in the East. You're also going to have that the neighboring Christians will be the enemies in the West versus Muslims will be the neighboring enemies in the East. So you have huge cultural, economic, and different barriers which are starting to divide West and East. The only thing that unites them, for any real purpose, is common faith. They all are Nicene Christians. Until something happens. In 1054, you have a patriarch who takes over Constantinople by the name of Michael Salarius. Michael Salarius, again, there's a nasty letter which is written by an Eastern bishop to a Western bishop criticizing the particular customs and practices of the Latin church and saying that these things are heretical. And so the Pope is going to be exceedingly suspicious that Michael Salarius, the patriarch, is behind it because Michael Salarius was itching for a fight, was itching actually to wrestle control, and that's what everyone was saying. So what he will do is he will send Cardinal Hubert to Constantinople. He'll send a legate to Constantinople to ensure and to put Michael Salarius back in his place. Michael Salarius will refuse to see the legate. And actually, it will be exceedingly rude, and it's a violation of hospitality and a violation of all the different principles, but he basically won't care. He won't see him. At the same time, the emperor is trying to make an alliance with the West, especially with the Pope, because of the Normans who are threatening to invade. As a result of this, the patriarch will rudely spurn Hubert and will refuse to meet with him. And then you will have that after several months is that Cardinal Hubert will blow up and that he will walk into the middle of Mass, the highest Mass on Sunday, and he will slam down a bull of excommunication, excommunicating Michael Salarius and anyone who follows him. The interesting thing about this is that the bull which he slams down on the altar, excommunicating the Patriarch of Constantinople for trying to dissolve the unity in the church, was illegal because the Pope was dead. And therefore, he had lost his authority. When the Pope died, he lost his authority. And he actually knew the Pope was dead, but he didn't care because he'd been sent there with a mission. He was going to accomplish it. He was going to force Salarius to accede to what was going on. And actually, you can say that Salarius, because Salarius will, in response, will actually excommunicate the dead Pope, which is also illegal. You can't excommunicate this. But this will be the cause of what's called the Great Schism. And so this spat, which is for the most part political, he will excommunicate this. You'll have the separation between Orthodox, Greek Orthodox in the West, in the East, and Latin Roman Catholic in the West. And this is the cause for the Great Schism. For the most part, most people don't even think of this as being, at the time, as being a real big deal. They just think that this is more prelates, more bishops, and people who don't have enough problems to deal with, that this is people just spatting. And this probably wouldn't have been a problem. Most people just go about their normal lives. Salarius, several years later, will actually be exiled and sent into exile, where he will die in exile for trying to actually do a coup of the emperor and overthrow the emperor and take over not only the bishopric or the Eastern Church, but also he wants to take control of the entire empire. So he will actually be exiled. He will die in exile. But 12 years later, you'll have actually the greatest military disaster in the Eastern Empire, which is that you will have the Muslims who have been fighting for a long period of time. The Seleucid Turks will finally be coming in and moving in, and they will take over. The Berber Turks, the ones in North Africa, for the most part, they were always militarily aggressive as well as hostile to Christianity, but they weren't as violent and as aggressive as the Seleucid Turks. But what will happen is that as the Seleucid Turks move in from Asia, you'll have a series of battles, and the most probably significant being in 1071 in Manzikert, where actually the emperor of the East will be taken hostage, and this will actually unite, and this is Sultan Arslan. He's probably the two of the most famous Muslims from the ancient world, Sultan Arslan and then Saladin in the Crusades. These are the two greatest military geniuses of Islamic forces. What he will do is he will take the prisoner of Manzikert, the emperor, and he will send the emperor back home. But knowing that what will happen is that a huge civil war will break out in the Eastern Empire and will actually fracture the Eastern Empire to the point where actually they will lose all of Turkey. And as a result of losing all of Turkey, they will also lose their ability to create and front an army, because their army came from Turkey. That was where they pulled all of their forces. So when they can no longer create an army out of Ankara or out of the Turkish frontier, that they lose the ability to create an army, and now they have to rely exclusively upon mercenaries, which is why as they lose more and more territory to the Muslims, is that finally when the Muslims are on the doorstep, or almost on the doorstep of the gates of Constantinople, is that in 1095, the emperor of Constantinople will send a message to the Urban II asking for mercenaries to be sent. And Urban II, as a result, will call the Great Crusade, the first Great Crusade, which will spark off the Crusades. And so that's really where you find, eventually though, the Crusaders will come into conflict with the, and in the Fourth Crusade, Constantinople will be sacked as kind of vengeance for the slaughter of Christians. There was about 70,000 Latin Christians who were slaughtered in one of their constant rebellions that were happening in Constantinople. They will have a genocide of all the Latin Christians. It's called the Massacre of the Latins. They will slaughter them, and then basically a few years later, you'll have the Fourth Crusade, and in vengeance, the Crusaders will come across and basically get screwed once again by the Byzantines, and they will sack the city, plunder it, pillage it, rape it, take over control of the city, and this will effectively end any type of reconciliation between the East and the West. And you'll find still to this day, the separation between Greek Orthodox, although in terms of faith, in terms of dogmas and doctrines, we don't really don't have a lot which separates us. Most of our faith is pretty much almost exactly the same. There's a few nuances here and there, but for the most part, this is where you're gonna start, this is where you will see the split, which leads to the Great Schism. And also, there'll be moments where they try to reconcile, but as soon as Constantinople is sacked by Crusaders in the Fourth Crusade, which brings the Fourth Crusade to a close, the Greeks are no longer ever interested in reconciliation. It's only in our today's modern times that we find that the Greeks are very interested, and that's where you find a lot of dialogue between Pope Francis, before him Pope Benedict, and John Paul II have been working very closely with the Greeks in terms of reconciling the schism. And actually, we're very, very close. The only thing which, for the most part, is actually holding back reconciliation with the Greek Orthodox Church right now is the Russian Orthodox. The Russians, who have a huge block, and because of the connection between Putin and the Russian church, is that the Russians are really dragging their feet and doing everything to try to stop reunification with the West, because they have no reasons and no desire to reunify with the West. But the Greeks are very interested in it, because a lot, especially when Constantinople is destroyed by Muslims in the 1400s, and they no longer have Constantinople, you've seen a lot of the diminishment in the terms of the Greek power. And so now there's a lot more dialogue, which is even existing to this day, in terms of trying to reunify the two churches. And we are very, very close.
Do you think what's going on now is the Muslims attacking the Christians in Turkey and Syria and all that, that is actually increasing the chances of that?
Yeah, the question was, is the fact that Christians are, especially Orthodox, Coptic, all the different, our Eastern brothers who are suffering such persecution, is this actually possibly pushing? And yes, the answer I would say is yes, because now it's becoming a force where they're being in danger of extermination. And so they need all the support that they can get, as well as not only prayer, but again, if we can reunify on a spiritual level with them, it makes, politically, as well as spiritually speaking, it's a lot easier for them to survive, because they've become swarmed by all the things that are happening with jihadists, Islamism, things like that. Any other questions? All right, let's close with a prayer. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to come together tonight. We ask you to keep us all safe on the way home. Help us to understand more fully your workings in the human history as you lead and guide us despite our brokenness. And help us, Lord, to work at preserving and working towards unity with all of our brothers and sisters throughout the world, both Christians and not. And help us, Lord, to be witnesses to the faith, witnesses to your love, and healing agents within your world. And we ask this all through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. All right. Have a good night.
Thank you.